entrepreneurship is more about the actions you take and not the person you are. If you take an action, you are obviously ahead of majority of the people who only talk about entrepreneurship but never build anything. My name is Winifred Ampiao. Join me today as I take you through on how to become a successful entrepreneur. Back from the break, you're still watching the CEO's Chair. The CEO's Chair is actually brought to you by Lakeside Estate. We also supported by Preforce Limited, and my wonderful fabric is by GTP New Style. New style, more colors, more designs. And I want to say thank you to Ikenate Essential Inside Osu for this wonderful outfit. Time to talk business. My guest today is the founder and managing director of Shaaba Enterprises Limited. He started a company in 1984 with a soap at Nkoko, dealing mainly in chainsaw and accessories for the timber industry. Identifying consumers' need, he expanded his operation to Accra and other cities and towns, extended their range of products to include quality household and electrical goods, as well as building materials. Through hard work and perseverance, he diversified into new ventures to bring the company to its present status as one of the leading commercial concerns in Ghana. Above all, he is also a politician. Let's take a look at who my guest is for today. You already know who my guest for today is. He is Dr. Seth Adjei, and today I'm privileged to have him to sit on the CEO's chair to talk about his experiences and also to motivate you out there, because basically what we want to do on this particular platform is to inspire you to start the thing or to do something that actually fears you or you always feel afraid to do. So first of all, let me take this opportunity to say, Doctor, you're welcome to the show.
Thank you very much.
It's a privilege to have you.
I'm honored to have you as well here.
You're always looking young, and I don't know if I should say fresh, but forgive me, but that's what I
think
see.
The right way to say is that, Doctor, you are very handsome.
Anyway, Doctor, you're handsome. I think we can't take that away from
that
you.
That is true. That one.
What's the secret?
I take good care of myself, and I try not to allow anything to worry me. Mm. I make sure that I do a bit of work.
Okay.
Then I eat well.
Wow. I'm sure viewers will want to know who exactly is Dr. Seth Adjei, but just give us a brief about yourself. Who are you?
Well, I'm a businessman,
okay,
a politician, one who loves to serve his people. That is all about me.
When you were growing up as a child, how was it like? Would you want to share with us your experiences when you were at that early stage? Some people would say that they were that very stubborn type. I don't know if you were.
Well, I was privileged to be born in a Christian home, very quiet and sober, always trying to look up to God for a breakthrough. So I was fortunate I had opportunity to go to school at an early stage, but along the line, I lost my father in secondary school form four, and that started the challenges. So after form five, there was a challenge how to continue. So I had to end my education and find something doing. And what could I have done at that time? It was the era of the revolution, 1981 revolution. So looking around, there was nothing to do, but there was a window of opportunity.
Yeah, that I was going to ask you, because I realized that you started the Shaaba Enterprises Limited in 1984.
Yes.
And what actually, if you could share with us your experiences, what
what happened was that when I finished school in 1981 and the revolution time, they said there was ban on importation of essential commodities. So all imported soap were banned and there was shortage of soap. So what everybody was doing was trying to make a way to live. Revolutionary era. So I also joined the wagon to learn how to do don't touch me soap.
At what age was that?
I was just 21 years old.
21.
So I learned how to do don't touch me soap. And at that time, I was able to, before I started the don't touch me soap, I was trying to do some canvassing, trying to get people for people, and I could save 5,000 old Ghana cedis, which is 50 pesos today. And that 5,000 is what I used to start the Don't Touch Me soap. I could buy the drum, I could buy firewood, I could buy salt, oil, caustic soda, soda ash, I credited all. And that is how I started.
But where did you learn it from? Was it something you knew or you had to pay to learn on the job?
If how you are determined to do something, you definitely go to where to learn it. I learned from some church members who were doing it. I remember when I went to one man to say that I want to learn, he said, ah, you go to school
at
to come and learn
21?
This? Then I said, what can I do? I want to do something for myself. So I learned it and I started doing it. Within 6 months, I had made enough money to be able to buy a lot of raw materials, and I raised 23,000 to start my first shop.
That's so 23,000 old CDs.
23,000 old CDs, which is 2 CDs, 30 pesos today. That is what I used to start my first shop. And I realized that for us men, we don't buy anything. So I started selling ladies' wear, panties, braziers, blouse, and all ladies' things. And because ladies want to spend, I was making the money gradually.
So you mean we like spending?
Well, ladies spend, and I know how to make them spend the money too.
So by identifying their needs?
You identify their needs, and ladies, you play on them with colors.
Cool.
So she has white, she wants cream. You bring cream, next time you bring a violet. Then they'll be buying. Because so long as they have the money, ladies will spend the money.
But tell us, at that time when you actually started, what were some of the challenges you confronted? Because you saw a need, there was a need, and then you realized that this need actually created an opportunity for you to actually produce something to meet the demand. At that stage or at that particular time, what were some of the challenges you encountered as a very young entrepreneur?
The main challenge at that point in time was that nobody was going to employ you. There was nothing for you to do. That was a challenge by itself. Secondly, you have no capital to do anything, was a challenge. You have no extra knowledge about anything, was a challenge. But when you look around you, the fields are white. In Ghana here, everything you touch is money. So I took advantage to join the Don't Touch Me soap. And I started within 6 months from 5,000 old Ghana cedis. I purchased a lot of raw materials. I could raise 23,000 cedis to start my first shop. So on that, I kept on till the economy was improving. They allowed the importation of foreign and other soaps from outside. So at that point in time, people were going back to those ones. So the demand for the Don't Touch Me was going down. So I just got out of it, concentrated on my shop. And from there, I grew it and developed it gradually.
And the shop, so what were you? You were into the ladies' wear,
the underwear.
I was
into the ladies' wear and other things. Then from there, I went into chainsaw machines and parts. Then from chainsaw machines and parts, I added household items. I went into electric cars. I've done a lot of things over the years to come this far.
But doctor, looking at the fact that after the Don't Touch Me soap that you started, you went into underwears, that's for ladies. Were there some form of stigmatization coming from friends, families, wondering why you decided to go into that particular trade? Did you experience any form of stigmatization at that time?
If you are to make money as a businessman, what is stigmatization? For me, I'm doing business. I remember once a colleague friend of mine came to the office and said, oh, a man who sells ladies wear. Then he picked one of the panties and stretched it and asked Kofi, can you wear one so that I can buy one for you? Then we started laughing. For me, I'm doing business. And business is business. Mm. I don't look at any other thing. I'm looking at the end of it that I want to make money and I've got to make money.
Who was actually inspiring you at that time? Because at the age of 21, I'm sure currently it's just a few people you would see who would want to go into business or who would want to actually stand on their own. But I know there was a challenge in furthering education, so you decided. But who actually inspired you? Where did you get your inspiration from?
Well, there's one thing that if really you are determined to do something, the first thing is to have a vision where you want to be. It could be a very big vision, but then you've got to start it small. Work towards it, develop it, and you'll be there. I knew one day I want to be there somewhere. I'm not there yet, but I believe I'll be there. And that inspires me to do more. That challenges me to challenge myself to move on to work. Mm. And that helped me from that initial stages until I got in touch with one man, Kwabena Dakon. When I listened to him, then I said, if he was able to make it, I will also make it.
So he was someone that you...
He became a mentor. Mm. I listened to him and I said, then I'll be challenged and I'll do more. And I started working hard and I'm here. I'm not there yet, but I can assure you I'll be there.
But Doctor, tell us, I know you now own a number of companies. People will be wondering, they knew of Shaaba Enterprises, but they probably don't know the breakdown of the kind of business you are into currently. Could you just give us an overview of the number of companies you have currently? And maybe if you could just emphasize briefly on those companies. We intend to motivate the young people, actually.
Well, we started with the Shaaba Enterprise. That's a household name in Ghana now, basically into trading. And along the line, we added construction. So we're doing construction. Everything you see around here was being constructed by our group. And so we added construction. From there, we decided to move on from construction to add manufacturing.
Okay.
As at now, we do assembling of gas and electric cookers in Ghana under the name Cooker Masters.
Mm-hmm.
We have the Shaaba processing, which is into fruit juices and mineral water. We have the Golden Blue Aluminium, which is into aluminium production. Then we are into this hospitality industry as well.
Hmm.
We are moving on gradually. As at now, we are importing organic fertilizer to Ghana, the first organic fertilizer company. Hmm. We are going to have a factory very soon here to see how we can capture or supply the West Africa sub-region. And all these things are things we are doing, preparing us to the ultimate, which of course I know will be there one day.
Sure, I will get to you. I'll get to find out what your ultimate goal is. But before that, tell us, at what point in time did you actually move or decide to involve politics into business? Because in Ghana, one would be wondering, why would a businessman want to combine politics? At what point did you decide, okay, it's time for me to do politics? At what point in time did you include politics?
I was introduced into politics by the same person, Dr. Kwabena,
who motivated you to become an entrepreneur.
Yes, he was my mentor, and I remember 1992 elections. I just heard he was contesting. And as a mentor, then I said, if he's contesting, I will support him. Whatever he will do, I will support him. So I got involved, followed him, I got addicted into politics. So when he quit politics, the whole thing has been in me. So once a while, it's like, you can do it. And you see, I was feeling that people should come to help the people, to serve the people. And why can't I do it?
So you went into politics to serve the people?
That was the mindset.
Mm.
So when I decided to get in, Well, I'm from Koko Kware area. I know predominantly everybody there is about 85% are MPP. So I decided to join the MPP tradition. As much as I tried, I'm one of the few people who was never given even membership card. I tried. They wouldn't give me any membership card, even wouldn't allow me to go for the primaries. So one day I decided that if you don't want me to go for the primaries, I'll go as independent. And that's how it started. And I went independent.
But why did they refuse to get you an MPP card?
Maybe I was a threat to somebody who wanted to be there on the seat forever. So when they saw me coming in, they said, no way. And I pushed and pushed and pushed. They still didn't allow me. So one day, somebody made a statement, if you think you are so popular, go and form your party. A very top member of the party. Then I said, is that it? And I went to Nkokwa, and the youth were strongly behind me. Then they said, if you are not going, none of us is going to vote. So the youth motivated me, and one day I said, I'll go along with you. I will put structures in place. People were saying that, oh, children's party, only children were following him. At the end of it all, I beaten the incumbent by 15,000 votes difference. Mm. Somebody who had been there for 3 terms, majority chief whip of the party, with all the party logistics, I beat him to it. That's how I started, and I joined the political fray. And I went to parliament, and I started doing a lot of things, and I got attached, and I got addicted.
Mm. So, well, has there been any regression in any way?
Well, if you are doing something, you are happy about what you are doing, you don't regret. There could be challenges and difficulties, because if you want to do well as a politician, you've got to sacrifice a lot of things. Mm. It could have affected my business around those days. But the fact is that I was satisfied with what I was doing. I didn't go into politics because I wanted money.
But why did you go into politics?
I went into it because I wanted to serve people, and I serve people, and I'm happy.
What did you do for them? Because I really want to know. You're saying that you actually went into politics not because of money. But what did you do for the people?
If you go to the constituency, the records are there.
No, do you want to share with us what exactly did you do for them?
I started with education.
Okay.
To support the youth. Mm. There were 16,800 school kids in the constituency. I tried as much as possible to open computer labs.
With your own money?
Some with my money, some with a common fund that has been given for the usage of the members of parliament.
Okay.
There were ladies I was training, and I bought sewing machines, hair dryers, and other things for them. I trained about 986 ladies into tie and dye and batik to set them up to work. I built schools for them. I started building clinic, which was roof. It's still there. I built another clinic at JJT. I did a lot of things. You see, because of the passion, even when I travel out, there were every clinic or hospital within the constituency. We gave them hospital beds, mattresses, and everything for free. People give me support to support the people. Most of the schools, we give them computers. If you go to the nurses, midwifery school, we give them computers. A lot of things, we're giving storybooks and other things just to motivate the youth to let them know that they can do it. And I think people are still calling. That's why you said I'm aging. Nothing worries me. I'm happy for what I'm doing. And if you are doing something, you are so happy, it doesn't stress you down. Mm.
So doctor, when you went into politics, you had a passion, actually. But you also need to, because you had a passion for it and you needed to serve the people by supporting them, you actually sacrificed your business at some point in time to do that. Didn't it cost you? Didn't you feel like I'm doing something that at the end of the day, people might not appreciate it?
What is your passion? Mm.
So it was passion that drove you to do that.
And if I'm happy, I'm happy. Sometimes it's not just all about money. It's about what makes you happy.
How much would you say you invested at that time?
Or you sacrificed? I don't want to mention figures.
In percentage-wise.
I know it cost us a lot. But then, I'm happy for what I did. And I have never regretted. And if I have the opportunity, I'll do it again.
All right, we'll go for a short break, but when we come back, we want to find out from Doctor, how is it like to combine politics and then business? What are the risks involved? I'm sure most of the young people out there will want to do politics and they also want to become an entrepreneur. And Doctor has an experience already. He will be sharing with us whether it's a good idea to go into politics and also become an entrepreneur. Or probably maybe stick to one, be a politician for life, or be an entrepreneur or a businessman, or combine both. If you want to combine both, what does it take to do that? Well, we'll go for a short break. When we come back, Doctor will be sharing more on this particular development.
Greenforce Limited is one of Ghana's foremost electrical engineering companies with expertise in the provision of street lighting, accessories and installation, among other electrical items. Through hard work and perseverance, Greenforce has made major inroads in the energy sector and carved a niche for itself in the delivery of quality work all over Ghana. The company is well noted for electrical construction and engineering, supply, distribution, wholesale and retail of electrical accessories, transformers, cables, fuses and arresters. Greenforce Limited intends to establish this factory to provide a one-stop and also to provide the best street lighting solution, including accessories from hoist tracks, spare parts, completed toolboxes, to climbing shoes, to all metropolitan, municipal and district assemblies and other state and private institutions in the construction and maintenance of their street lights.
With over 11 years' experience in the housing industry and providing quality, affordable houses to Ghanaians, Lakeside Estate, the premier real estate company, is offering a great selection of homes for sale to families. Housing solution in one-bedroom, two-bedroom townhomes, two-bedroom semi-detached, three-bedroom semi-detached, and three-bedroom detached with three-bedroom duplex semi-detached, and four-bedroom executive also detached, all with one-stop solar installation and flexible payment. The environment offers sociable amenities like the marina park for all locations with pedalo boats and one canoe for water fun activities open to the public. So, looking to find a great selection of homes? Then visit the Lakeside Estate, which provides affordable and quality houses in a self-sufficient and supportive neighborhood, enabling every family to enjoy a comfortable living. Locate us at Ashalabuche North, few meters drive from Medina, or visit our office on the 7th floor of the Silver Star Towers Airport City. Call us on 0302-775043, fax 0302-782-991, or our website www.lakesideestate.com. Lakeside Estate, homes you can afford.
Business challenges are really dynamic, and corporate organizations need dynamic leaders and leadership to enhance efficiency and productivity. The fact still remains that business competitions are among the key reasons why businesses have to develop core values and core competency. It is for this reason that the CEO's chair is creatively designed to host distinguished and successful corporate leaders such as chief executive officers, managing directors, among others. The program is expected to be very innovative for business decision making. In effect, the CEO's chair shall reveal vital information for business decision making, growth strategies, and global perspective in business challenges. Join me, Winifred Ampiao, as I will bring you a refresh and sharpen the managerial abilities and enhance business decision making of young entrepreneurs. So you welcome back from that break. Just want to remind you that this show is proudly sponsored by Preforce Limited and Lakeside Estates. We have been speaking to Dr. Seth Adjei, and quite an interesting revelation. But we want to find out from him, Doctor. You are a politician and you're also into business. I'm sure most young people want to find out. Combining politics and business, how is it like?
Well, it's quite challenging though, because in this part of our world, when it comes into politics, people begin to hate their own people. I remember when I got into politics, immediately I just started. Then there was an instruction that all bank facilities should be withdrawn because he's politically exposed. That was the first attack.
That was your first attack?
Attack. And within a shortest period of time, you are supposed to, if you have taken loans running into millions of old cities, and they say within 2-3 months, you got a refund because you are politically exposed.
But what was the rationale for doing that? Because was it coming from your party?
It's coming from somewhere. I wouldn't want to talk about
because
the
sources. at that time it was NPP who was actually in government, and if you claim that they said it was it's politically driven, then probably
the
I'm
banks
not too
were
sure.
Saying I'm politically exposed, so I cannot continue to be having facilities, so I've been given a time to return those monies. And yes, I did my best, but when you are into investments and you have put a lot of money into structures and other things, sometimes it makes it quite difficult. So it was a big challenge. By then, that was the instructions. A lot of pressure from all angles.
Have funds been already been disbursed to you?
Funds has been disbursed. I had 4 factories working. I've started this hotel. I've done a lot of things. They tell you you are politically exposed. We found every facility.
Was it, they gave you a period to?
Within about 3 months. And it was a big challenge. But so long as you are determined to do something, I don't budge. I move on to do what I think I want to do.
So what did you do?
As much as I could. It wasn't easy. It was the beginning of the greater challenges, but God was with me.
What did you do?
So what I did, I tried paying. Those I couldn't pay, I would go on rescheduling, finding a way until I was able to get all these things sorted out.
Didn't you feel at that particular time that, okay, I just want to just throw in the towel. I don't want to become a politician. Let me concentrate on my business so I get facilities. Didn't you give up?
If my dream and desire is to do this, nothing stops me. I'll move on to do it. Nothing stops me. I knew there were challenges, difficult times were ahead, but I was determined that I've started this, I'll get there. And I got there. And I'm proud to say that I'm one of the few independent members of parliament, and I cherish the time being in parliament. I did my best to support my country and my community, and I have never regretted.
Doctor, let me just find out. Let's take Ghana for instance. Looking at the current economic challenges confronting us, and at that time, I'm sure there were challenges, but it wasn't as it is now. Do you think that young people of today will be able to stand the challenges to become an entrepreneur like you did in your time?
It's having a dream. They have better opportunities than me. I started with just an ordinary level. It was when I decided to get into politics. I had a first degree at the age of 40. Before I did my master's, I started moving on. Most of the young ones have finished their first degrees already. Mm-hmm. They have better opportunities. What are they waiting for? If you're in a country where there are a lot of challenges, it gives you an opportunity to make wealth. Because addressing those challenges is an opportunity to make money.
So, Doctor, you're saying that the current challenges we are going through as a country, the opportunities within.
There are opportunities for us to make money.
So there are opportunities out there for the young
people.
Yes. What opportunities do you see? Probably some people are not seeing. Would you want to share some opportunities you can see currently that you think that if any young person watching us decide to invest his or her money into, the person will be able to make something out of it?
You know, when people want to start,
okay,
they want to start very big, start driving in cars with big portfolios to say that they are there. Business, you got to start it right from the scratch. Somebody came to me, he wanted to, a lady wanted to do some business. She needed 10 million those days. Then I look at her, I said, you don't need 10 million. What do you want to do? I listened to her. One, she hasn't gotten the money, the knowledge about the business. She wants to do it because people are doing it. Then I said, young lady, can I help you? Then she said, yes. Then I said, okay, where do you live? She described the area. I said, do you know one thing? It's a newly developing area. Why don't you start frying yams over there? She turned like this. I said, frying yams, you don't need more than 300. You need a cold pot, some charcoal, 5 tubers of yams, 1 gallon of fried oil. Start something. She was reluctant. She went around and she couldn't get money. She just came back again. I said, start frying yams. The person started frying yams. After some few months, she added kaloli. Within a period of 6 months, she was having a spot. Everybody who comes home will want to go and buy fried yams and kaloli. At a point in time, the 10 million she was looking for, the value of the project was more than that. But she started from the scratch with 300.
Doctor.
Young guys should start from the scratch. They should look around us. When you look around, a young guy came to me. She said she was looking for something to do. I said, young guy, what did you do? She said she did agriculture. I said, wonderful. Can you get a mower? This is a residential area. If you go and mow a lawn and somebody gives you 20 cedis, you do 5 a day, it's 100 cedis. After 1 month, 2 months, you can buy 2 mowers. You employ 1 man in addition. You are from a company. You started trying to trim people's houses, gardens, and other things. And it's a business. Everybody wants to wear a tie to sit at the bank as a bank manager. I don't believe in that. There are a lot of small, small things we can do around us to help us to make money. Whoever thought that collecting garbage can make somebody a billionaire? It's happening. So people should not look up. They should look down and look around them. If you see any challenge around you, find a way to address that issue. By addressing that issue, you'll be making money.
So, Doctor, you from what you're saying, it means that there are a lot of opportunities currently looking at, despite the challenges we are going through as a country.
Yes.
Is it to say that the youth of today haven't been able to, they haven't been given the encouragement enough, or they haven't motivated themselves enough to be able to take charge of some of these opportunities?
Some of the challenges we have is our educational system.
I was going to ask that.
People are trained along that line that I'm coming out of school for somebody to employ me. In my life, the first time I had salary was when I was in parliament. And I employ a lot of people.
You never worked for anyone?
I never worked for anybody. The first time I received salary in my life was in parliament. And when they gave me the salary, I look at it, I said, wow, I'm in for it, but I enjoy what I'm doing, so I was encouraged to do it. If it were the salary, I would have resigned the first day I went to parliament.
It's not encouraging?
Oh, it's service to the people. That's what I say. If it's about the salary, then I don't have to be there. I don't have to be there because I'm a businessman. I know the value of money. I know where to make the money and how to make it. So the education should prepare us and train us and make it open for us to do anything. So that when you get out there, you don't sit down to expect that somebody will work and come and employ you. No, you have to be able to make sure that after of school, you'll be able to do something for yourself.
All right, so we'll go for a very short break. When we come back, we're just about wrapping up the program. I'm sure you're enjoying yourself. It says the CEO's Chair right here on BTA. And my name is Winifred Ampia. We'll be right back after this break.
Preforce Limited is one of Ghana's foremost electrical engineering companies with expertise in the provision of street lighting, accessories and installation among other electrical items. Through hard work and perseverance, Preforce has made major inroads in the energy sector and carved a niche for itself in the delivery of quality work all over Ghana. The company is well noted for electrical construction and engineering, supply, distribution, wholesale and retail of electrical accessories, transformers, cables, fuses and arresters. Preforce Limited intends to establish this factory to provide a one-stop and also to provide the best street lighting solution, including accessories from hoist tract, spare parts, completed tool boxes, to climbing shoes, to all metropolitan, municipal, and district assemblies and other state and private institutions in the construction and maintenance of their street lights.
With over 11 years' experience in the housing industry and providing quality, affordable houses to Ghanaians, Lakeside Estate, the premier real estate company, is offering a great selection of homes for sale to families. Housing solution in one-bedroom, two-bedroom townhomes, two-bedroom semi-detached, three-bedroom semi-detached, and three-bedroom detached with three-bedroom duplex semi-detached, and four-bedroom executive also detached, all with one-stop solar installation and flexible payment. The environment offers sociable amenities like the marina park for all occasions with pedalo boat and one canoe for water fun activities open to the public. So, looking to find a great selection of homes? Then visit the Lakeside Estate, which provides affordable and quality houses in a self-sufficient and supportive neighborhood, enabling every family to enjoy a comfortable living. Locate us at Ashalabuche North, few meters drive from Medina, or visit our office on the 7th floor of the Silver Star Towers Airport City. Call us on 0302-775043, fax 0302-782-991, or our website www.lakesideestate.com. Lakeside Estate, homes you can afford.
Business challenges are really dynamic, and corporate organizations need dynamic leaders and leadership to enhance efficiency and productivity. The fact still remains that business competitions are among the key reasons why businesses have to develop core values and core competency. It is for this reason that the CEO's chair is creatively designed to host distinguished and successful corporate leaders such as chief executive officers, managing directors, among others. The program is expected to be very innovative for business decision making. In effect, the CEO's chair shall reveal vital information for business decision making, growth strategies, and global perspective in business challenges. Join me, Winifred Ampiao, as I will bring you a refresh and sharpen the managerial abilities and enhance business decision making of young entrepreneurs. So you're back, and it's still the CEO's chair right here on BTA, and we're being sponsored by Lakeside Estate and Prefox Limited. We still have Dr. Seth Adjei, and he is the founder of Shaaba Group, and we're privileged. He's been telling us a lot of things that we need to know as an entrepreneur, and telling us that it is very important that you need to start small. So whatever idea you have, start it It doesn't matter the size, just start it and start small. And I'm very, very excited because I'm learning a lot myself, and I'm sure you're also learning. You can follow us on our Facebook page. Just go to CEO's Chair on Facebook page and share with us your comments or what you make about this particular program. So, Doctor, you're still welcome to the program.
Thank you very much. We're most grateful for the discussion.
Doctor, I want to find out, and it's really not, because the first time I asked, how do you think that the youth of today should combine politics and business? You shared with us your challenges, like when you did a combination, you had calling for their facilities, asking you to return it. Do you think that it's prudent if any young person wants to go into business, do you think that they should combine politics?
Well, I think if you think you want to be a politician, be a politician. Mm. But it is always best for you to start life, to understand life, okay, to be your own man before you get into politics. So that when you get into politics, you speak your mind as it is. But if you start straight from politics and you are being pushed there, sometimes you are compelled not to speak your mind. You have to go along a line. Mm. But I know that when I went to politics, I always used to speak my mind, and I still speak my mind on the issue. Because I thank God I have to do that, because maybe I'm not under any whip, or I'm not threatened that if I'm out of parliament, I have nothing doing. I have something doing. I have something behind me. So I speak my mind as it is and make sure that I'm doing the right thing for my people. So I think young ones, yes, they want to do politics. They should start life to understand what life is. Then from there, they can go into politics and be efficient and better politicians.
All right. Doctor, you also made mention of the fact that our educational system, we need to change the way our educational system is in terms of our curriculum. I want to find out from you, what exactly would you call that, or would you recommend that we have an entrepreneurship course included in our curriculum? That from the early stage,
we've called for this some long ago, and we're expecting schools to look at it to prepare the people for the world. So when you are coming out, you have the zeal and desire to do things for yourself. And if we're able to do that, it will help us.
What would be your advice to the young people? You realize that most young people have the perception about becoming an entrepreneur. It's in Ghana, it's quite difficult, and there are challenges. How do you survive to become an entrepreneur? Banks will not give you credits, and even if they will, you don't even have the collateral to meet the kind of funds you want to take
if
from
you
these
look at the difficulties and the
what
challenges,
would be your
you
advice
not do
to
anything
them?
Good. Mm. But when you see an abstract darkness, behind the darkness, the light will shine. Don't let things be a stumbling block. If you are determined to do it, move ahead. Have a vision, work towards it, and you'll be there. Mm. It's just a matter of having a vision, working seriously, and being disciplined. You'll be there. It's not always about money. It's about the vision you have. And when you work towards it, all other things will fall in line. In Ghana, most companies are started by support from friends, family, and relations. Banks will come in when you are established and they know you are doing well, you have the money. In case of anything, they have something to fall on. Mm. And that is how it is. So you should be determined to work. You should not come out and think that the first day you start, you should be driving in a Porsche, Mercedes-Benz, or a car. If somebody sees me driving in a Benz, let me tell you one story. When I was going to have my wedding, 1985, I nearly had a wedding with a taxi. Because somebody who had promised me a car, at the morning of the wedding said that the Pentecost people are using his car for wedding 2 months, so he wasn't going to give the car to me. So I called a friend to call a taxi for me. Then, but a friend was coming for the wedding from Accra. They said, no, don't do it that way. So he gave me his car and took the taxi. That is how I got a car for my wedding. I didn't have a car. But 2-3 years after, what is car? By the grace of God, I had whatever car I wanted to have at that tender age. You see, it was a matter of working towards something, having a vision, and being determined to work seriously. If you are doing that, you'll definitely be there. So they should prepare to have a vision, be prepared to sacrifice. When I was doing the Don't Touch Me show, I was starting as early as 4 a.m. I finished at 11 p.m. I'm the purchasing officer, the production manager, the marketing officer, the everything. I start for the employee will come at 7. I split the firewood myself, set the fire, and start preparing the soap. Somebody hears and says, yeah, that is what I was doing. And those days, I was so disciplined and determined that I'll make a certain amount per day. Mm. I was living on kenke and eggs. I used to buy one crate of eggs, 30 pieces. I use water heater to boil one in the morning. I buy kenke and eat with it. Kenke is being taken with fish or sardine. But that was the cheapest I could afford at that time. But I was determined that every month I was going to save so much. And I did that religiously. Even though I owe all these things, I'm still on salary. So when I'm hot, I buy plantain and granules and eat it. I remember one of my staff said, I'm a dieter. Every day, plantain and granules.
Coffee broke man.
He had the opportunity to go out to Italy. Then he called me one day and said, dieter, I now realize you trained us. You see? I could have said, give me 200, let me go for lunch, give me this, but I try to live on my salary.
But that's what you
see. I paid myself.
Is that what you see among the young people today?
They look at the project, they're expecting so much to come out of it, they start enjoying the profit before the things are sold. This project, I'll make 5 million. So the first thing is that you buy 1 million worth of a phone. Even though he's not using the services on the phone. Mm. Most of our ladies in the universities.
Doctor, why do you keep referring to ladies?
Because they are the most expensive around.
Because I know guys also spend. You're not being fair to
they
us.
Should forgive me. My ladies,
so please,
forgive me.
Forgive him.
But the truth is that all the money we spend on you.
It's not true. It's not true. Because I think that currently the culture is beginning to change and ladies are trying their best to become very, very...
When I started importing, let me tell you why, I started importing Coleman ice chests to Ghana. So I brought Coleman ice chests, I started with blue color. The ladies were buying it, maybe I have a wedding, I have a funeral, I have this, I have this. They'll buy it, after 3 months, I'll bring wine color. The same people will come and buy the wine color. I'll leave it for about another 3 months, then I'll bring gray. Then I realized that the only thing is to do something to attract them and they'll spend the money on them. I was changing the colors every now and then and someone, I don't have this color. So if you go to somebody's house, he has about 7 or 8 different types of ice chests. If you ask them, they say, when my child is going to have an engagement or a wedding or when I have a funeral.
They are preparing for the future.
How often? You can go and rent it and pay some small money and use that money to do something else.
Probably one day.
I'm just trying to come into priorities. How do we use our money?
You're
when
right.
I started all these things, I had 4 battery tape in my room. 4 battery tape. I used it religiously until it got to a time I think I could just afford a tape and put it in my room. Because at the end of it, when colleagues were buying big gadgets, making noise, dancing, and other things, I had 4 battery tape. It's the priority. What do you have ahead of you? What is your vision? Work towards it. All other things could be secondary. When we're able to achieve the ultimate, all other things will follow. It got to a time I could buy anything I wanted to buy. Anything I wanted to buy. But during the good old days, I was living on cake and egg. Now, by the grace of God, I've come this far. I want to challenge the youth that they can do it. They have better opportunities than me. They have better education. At this point in time, they can do a lot for themselves in Mother Ghana. They should not look out there and asking people to employ them. Every business is business. It depends on the way you handle it, the way you approach it, and the way you position and package yourself. There are a lot of things happening around us. Let's look at the problems. If you see that this is a problem, ask yourself, how do I address that problem? How do I change the filter around to make the city clean? By sitting down to think through, it will give you some money. As soon as you start changing it, it gives you money. I went to Thailand in November. All the plastic waste that is littering around, destroying our seashore and all these things, they collect them, devise machinery, put them in and get diesel out of it. So those who are even collecting the plastic waste are making good hell of money. If somebody is asked to go and collect plastic waste, form a company to collect plastic waste, you say, this is cheap work. I've been to school. Yes, we have been to school to better our lot. You have been to school to make sure that things work better. The things you come to meet, you make a change. So if there's something wrong, let's use education to change them. And whilst we are changing them, it will give us wealth.
I am speechless because Doctor has actually said it all. There are challenges confronting us, and there are opportunities within those challenges. All we need to do as young people, all we need to do, irrespective of what age you are, I believe it is never too late. So all you need to do is to just take a step. Take that fear factor off and then start from the scratch. It doesn't matter what you have. Be willing to sacrifice, and I'm sure one day you will be on the CEO's chair to share your story with us. But Doctor, I want to say thank you so much. But we're not just saying a verbal thank you. And we have this, and on behalf of the entire production team and on behalf of our sponsors, want to say thank you to you. And this is something very small we have. We hope you appreciate it.
Thank you very much. And I'm proud of you. The fact that I've had the opportunity to tell Ghanaian youth that it will be well. They should stand with us, and together we can make it and develop our country. It's more than enough satisfaction. I appreciate this, and I'll take it home and ask my wife to open it.
Oh.
And give it to her as a token.
Okay.
But giving me 1 hour to be to the
TV CEO's
station
chair.
And CEO's chair, I think for her precious 1 hour given to me, this is for her.
Oh, that's so nice. I'm speechless, though, seriously. But I want to say thank you. But basically, what we intend doing on this show is not just a talk show. We want to inspire you, want to inspire the young people out there. We know we have viewers all over the country, across Africa as well. We want you to stand up. If there's something you want to do, don't wait for your parents, don't wait for government. Take that bold initiative and do it. And I believe one day you would get the opportunity to share your story as Dr. Seth Adjei Bajes did on this particular platform. I want to say thank you to you, and Doctor, thank you so much for coming.
Thank
it's
you
a pleasure
much.
Having you
thank
on the
you.
CEO's
I'm
chair.
Honored to be with
thank
you.
Thank you so much.
Thank
we
you.
Appreciate it.
Good.
Thank you.
Fine.
So we want to say thank you so much, Doctor. It's been so, so great. And I have been really been informed. I've been educated as well on what we need to do. We don't need to be, ladies are not supposed to be swayed away with colors. So therefore, if I see blue, I won't buy the green or yellow. So I'll try as much as possible and put priority. But I'm sure viewers have also learned something about this particular development. Or when it comes to starting a business or becoming an entrepreneur, Doctor shared an insightful story with us on how he actually became an entrepreneur. And he's not just an entrepreneur, he's also a politician. And he's been able to combine both. And he is where he is currently. He says this is not his final stage. We'll follow up with him and find out where his final destination would be. At what point would doctor say that, okay, I am satisfied? We'll
it
come
is
back
not over
again.
Until it is over.
Indeed, it is not over until it is over. So I want to say thank you, Doctor, for coming. We
thank
appreciate
you very
we
much.
Appreciate
I'm also
your
grateful
time.
To be with you.
We appreciate it.
Thank you.
So viewers, that's all we have for you on this particular platform. And it is the CEO's chair. Just want to remind you that this show, it's on your screen. And just follow us on our Facebook page. That's the CEO's chair. Share with us your comments. Tell us your story. Tell us what motivated you. Tell us who you want to see on this particular platform. We also want to say thank you to our sponsors. We've been sponsored by Preforce Limited. Thank you so much to Preforce Limited. We also were sponsored by Lakeside Estate. And the fabric of my costume was by GTP New Style. New style, more colors, more design. And I want to say thank you to Ikenati Essential for this wonderful design. I am so grateful. Thank you so much for making it possible. And to all the production team, I can't mention their names, but we have Franca, we have Mark, we have Ben, and the entire production team. I want to say thank you so much for making this show a success. We'll be back same time next week on your show. All right, so it is the CEO's chair. My name is Winifred Ampia. So see you, but remember, be positive. Business challenges are really dynamic, and corporate organizations need dynamic leaders and leadership to enhance efficiency and productivity.
The fact still remains that business competitions are among the key reasons why businesses have to develop core values and core competency. It is for this reason that the CEO's chair is creatively designed to host distinguished and successful corporate leaders such as chief executive officers, managing directors, among others. The program is expected to be very innovative for business decision making. In effect, the CEO's chair shall reveal vital information for business decision making, growth strategies, and global perspective in business challenges. Join me, Winifred Ampiao, as I will bring you a refresh and sharpen the managerial abilities and enhance business decision making of young entrepreneurs.